Hello, everyone. Welcome to another vodcast by Mr. Mahan. This vodcast is vodcast number two in the equilibrium unit. So I'm assuming that you've already watched vodcast number one and you have an idea what equilibrium is about. If you haven't, you might want to go back and watch that. So today's equilibrium vodcast is going to get into the equilibrium constant. So today's going to be all about how to write them, how to work with them, whether they're the KCs, like you see on the reference sheet. Perhaps your professor or your teacher calls them KEQs, which I'll reference those as well. This is also going to get into a little bit of KP action. And then later on, when we get into acids and bases, we're going to use this same skill to work with KAs, KBs, and even the KW of water. So this is a big moment in the unit of equilibrium. And so hopefully this vodcast will help. And then the second half of today's vodcast is going to get into actually completing calculations and looking at your algebra skill. So let's jump into it, right? So as we previously learned, it turns out that we think a lot of reactions go to completion, but in reality, the reactions don't. To our naked eye, it looks like no more product is being created, but that's because it's reached the state of equilibrium where the forward reaction and the backward reaction rates equal each other, right? So maybe I'm creating five products, but at the same time I'm creating five products, I'm decomposing five products back into reactants. So although I've gained five, I've lost five, so therefore there's no change at all. Now, at first glance, okay, why is that an issue? Well, here, this is why it's an issue. So it's good news because it's like, yeah, buddy, yeah, man. It's all excited because there's no more stoichiometry. Get it out. We cannot use stoichiometry with equilibrium reactions because not all of the reactant has fully reacted, right? So previously, maybe we were looking at the synthesis of magnesium chloride. So you reacted 3 grams of magnesium. How many grams of magnesium chloride would that be? And we would do the dance, right? We would do that whole stoichiometry thing. Well, we can't do that because not all 3 grams of this magnesium reactant are going to actually react. And so this created a huge problem because if and when we want to actually do math with reactions, which is like, oh, I don't know, always, we can't use stoichiometry anymore. But have no fear, the Norwegians to the rescue. So you can see our two Norwegian scientists right up there. I'm not even going to try and pronounce the names because I'll probably completely butcher them, but we'll give them credit nonetheless. So they did this crazy high level math. You don't have to know why or how they did what they did, but you do have to know that they figured out that at a given temperature, this is very important, that at a constant temperature, we're always going to reach the same state of equilibrium, and that state of equilibrium is going to have this thing we call a constant value. Now, if you were in class when we did the little modeling equilibrium nickel activity, you saw that that P to R ratio was the same. That's exactly what we're talking about. So if I look at this reaction, A reacting with B to produce C and D, if we think of A as having some kind of coefficient, lowercase a, B having some kind of coefficient, lowercase b, same thing with C and D having their coefficients be the lowercase of them, right? We have our reactants on the left. We have our products on the right. What we're going to do is we're going to take that P to R ratio, that P to R ratio we did in the activity, and we're going to morph it and we're going to evolve it into what you see below here. So this is the same format to follow. This is the generic format to follow for all equilibrium type reactions. Anytime you hear the word equilibrium constant, K for constant, this is what you got to engage thrusters on. Now, this actually is on your reference sheet. So if you actually have a AP chemistry reference sheet with you currently, I suggest that you take that out. And if you look on the front page, the second block down on the left, you'll see that they react this, or I'm sorry, they provide this and write this the same exact way, but they call it K sub C. They call it KC instead of KEQ because this is going to be based upon concentration of reactant. Remember that anytime you see brackets around a reactant or a product, you should think concentration. So when I read this equilibrium statement, it's K, the equilibrium constant value, equals the concentration. That's what brackets means. The concentration of C raised to the power of whatever its coefficient is, times the concentration D raised to the power of its coefficient divided by the concentration of A to its coefficient and B to its coefficient. Now, if I had more products, I would have more terms in my numerator here in my KQ or my KC statement. If I had more reactants, I'd have more on the denominator. So we would just continue to do this for as many reactants or as many products as we have. Okay, and this is what we call the equilibrium constant. Again, most textbooks report it as KEQ. On the reference sheet, they started a couple years ago calling it KC because, again, we're doing concentrations. That's what the brackets mean. A little bit of math for you. If you're not so good at math, if you're not so good with algebra, if we do have a KEQ value greater than 1, what that tells me is that my numerator must have significantly been greater than my denominator. And so if I have a KEQ greater than 1, that means I have more products than I do reactants, which means that equilibrium lies far to the right. Okay, equilibrium lies far to the right. I have more products than I do reactants. Flip side to that, if I have a KEQ that's less than 1, if you don't really quite understand math and how it all works, if my KEQ value is less than 1, what that means now is that my denominator must be greater than my numerator, and so therefore I must have more reactants than I do products, which means that equilibrium is far to the left, or that equilibrium sits to the left because I have more reactants than I do products. So again, anytime we write our KEQ or our KC statements, it's always products over reactants, always P over R, just like what we saw in that little activity in class. So in dealing with equilibrium, we're going to have two different types of equilibrium. We're going to have what's called homogeneous or homogeneous equilibrium, and then we're also going to have heterogeneous equilibrium. When we talk about homogeneous and heterogeneous, we're talking about states of matter. So if I look at the synthesis of hydroiodic acid, if I look at hydrogen gas reacting with iodine gas to produce hydroiodic acid, all three of them are gases, and so we would call this homogeneous equilibrium. And since they're all the same state of matter, we would actually write them down and we would write the K statement just like what you would see here. So I would say KC or KEQ would be the concentration of the hydroiodic acid. It does have a coefficient, so I would raise that to the power of 2. And I'm going to divide that by the concentration of H2. It has a coefficient of 1, so I'm going to write that coefficient of 1 in there. I don't have to write it, but just trying to show you a little more than what you maybe even need. But the same thing with the iodine. The iodine has no coefficient, so it's got a coefficient of 1. And so if they asked me to write the K statement or the equilibrium statement for this reaction, I would write it just as you see here. With that in mind, I'm going to pause the thing, this vodcast via Edpuzzle. Do your best to just type it in into the Edpuzzle what the KEQ or the KC statement would be. I know you can't really do fractions, but do the best that you can. All right, so if you did pause it and you did take a look, this is homogeneous. All three states of matter are gas, gas, gas. So I would write my KEQ or KC, whatever you want to write, equals, I do have a product, so I put that in brackets. It did have a coefficient, so I'd raise it to the power of 2. The N2 gets raised to the power of 1, and the H2 gets raised to the power of 3. So again, you can see here I only had one product, so I only have one numerator. I have two reactants, so I have two denominators. Again, real quick, I'm going to pause it and ask you to write in the K statement. If you're watching via YouTube, I would stop and write it on my own as well. All right, so again, this is homogeneous. Only one product and one reactant. Both are gases. So KEQ or KC, whatever you want to call it, is the concentration of NO2 raised to the power of 2, and then over the concentration of N2O4 to the power of 1. All right, so I mentioned the fact that we do have this stuff called heterogeneous and homogeneous equilibria. So here's an example of one, right? So this is ethanol, and this is ethanol actually evaporating. This is it going from a liquid to a gas. So we can see that we have two different states of matter, right? Now, with that, turns out we have a huge moment here. Liquids and solids in this case, are what we call pure substances. They're pure. This is pure ethanol. It's not dissolved in water. It's not aqueous. It's not anything of that nature. So anytime you have a liquid or solid, something that's pure, their concentration is going to be constant, because if I decrease the volume of substance, I'm also going to decrease the moles of substance. And remember, concentration equals molarity, and molarity equals moles over liters. So if I have a pure substance, if I lose some moles, I lose some liters. If I lose some liters, I lose some moles. So we don't have to put anything that's a liquid or a solid into our equilibrium statements, because they're not going to change. Their concentrations are not dependent on how much liquid is there. Their densities are constant. So we do not include liquids or solids, because they are pure substances. We do not include them in my KEQ statements. So if I were to write a KEQ statement for this evaporation, I only care about gases and aqueous things. So I'm going to take my gas, and I do write that in brackets. It did not have a coefficient, so it's like I raised it to the power of 1. And it's like I'm putting this over one, or I'm putting this over nothing that I'm going to multiply or divide by, because this is a liquid. So any liquids or solids we just completely ignore. And so the KEQ for this is just KEQ equals the concentration of that gaseous ethanol. Again, there's me telling you and throwing you in that the solids are also emitted. All right, so same type of thing. Do the best that you can to type this into Edpuzzle. I'm going to stop it. If you're watching via YouTube, I would pause and I would try this problem on my own. All right, so we have a heterogeneous equilibrium again. So whether you want to call it KC or KEQ, I go to my first product. My first product is a solid. We do not include solids or liquids in our KEQ statements, so I don't write it. I move on to my second product. It is gaseous, so yes, sir, that's going to get put in the KC to KEQ statement. And it was to the power of one. Same thing with the water. It too is a gas. So yes, sir, put it up in there and raise it to the power of one. And now when I come back and check my reactant, my one reactant that I have, it too is a solid. So I do not include it. So the equilibrium and the equilibrium constant is all about our gases, never about our liquids or our solids. All right, so the next evolution of these equilibrium statements and these equilibrium constants is that now that we have a way to actually relate all of the reactants to the products and vice versa, we can now kind of do some bastardized stoichiometry, if you will. Now we can actually calculate if we have every other value except for one, it's just algebra. We could solve for the missing one. So in this case, they're asking me to calculate the value of KEQ, the actual equilibrium constant itself, if the following reaction, the synthesis of ammonia, going back to that original OG reaction we had in the first vodcast, if this is my synthesis of ammonia, calculate the KEQ for me. Well, anytime I see calculate equilibrium constant, I got to write the equilibrium constant first. Always write this. Always write it. This is kind of like when in doubt, mull it out. You almost always get a point on the open-endeds if you just write the KEQ, even if you have no clue how to solve it. Just writing it usually almost gets you a point, right? So it's a little pro tip for you. I take my ammonia, I put it in my numerator, I raise it to the power of two because it's gaseous. I would take my nitrogen, put it in the denominator because it is gaseous, put my hydrogen in the denominator because it's gaseous. I do have homogeneous equilibria here. And so then at this point, they now gave me the concentration values, or maybe they were calculated in an earlier step or in an earlier part of this question. So now it's just simple plug and chug. I know this value, I know this value, I know this value. If I know three out of the four terms, I can calculate the fourth. And so I would just simply plug it in, 0.933 squared, 0.533, 1.6 cubed. I would square the top, multiply out the bottom, 3 sig figs divided by 3 sig figs times 4 sig figs. I'm only allowed 3 sig figs. And so I actually would report 0.399. And here's a good thing for all those people that are a little bit lazy with units. The equilibrium constants have no units in them. So we just kind of magically get rid of this mole, this molar, this molar. But notice that I did put my units in the work itself. And so it's really just going to be algebra at this point. We're really just going to set up by writing our KEQs every time and then look at what values were provided for me, what values are missing, and kind of figure out the algebra from there. All right, so I'm going to pause the video at this point via Edpuzzle. If you have a calculator, you can use it. You can use the app on your phone. But what's the KEQ that you would get for the following reaction? All right, so if you did try the problem and you worked it out, again, I'm going to write my KEQ or KC, whatever you want to call it. I'm going to take that and I'm going to, again, homogeneous equilibria, put products over reactants, square my product, divide by my reactant to the first power. Again, they were very nice here and already provided it for me in molarity. So it's just a simple plug and chug. Report to 3 sig figs because that's my lowest number of sig figs and no units. So it would be 0.21. All right, so getting a little bit crazy here. Calculate the KEQ for the following reaction. Again, I'm going to stop this. I'm going to ask you to take a look at it. But here we go. So you know the concentration of your sodium bicarbonate. You know your concentration of sodium carbonate, your water, and even the carbon dioxide. So calculate it up. Now this is a sheep alert. This is a sheep. Whoop, whoop, mean, oh, mean, oh, mean, oh. No sheepies here, right? This is actually heterogeneous equilibria. So I only care about gases or aqueous in KEQ statements or KC statements. All I care about is gases or aqueous. So I only had my two products. I ignore this product. I ignore this product because they are solids. And so look, they gave you extra information that you did not need, but I plug in my amount for my carbon dioxide, plug in my amount for water, multiply it out, 3 sig figs times 3 sig figs, and again, no units. Okay, so just kind of straightforward algebra. All right, so of course we can't just stop there, right? That would be way too easy to just always calculate KEQs. So the other reason why this is super important and super powerful is remember that these brackets here, here, are actually concentration, right? When you see brackets, think concentration. And when you think concentration in molarity, or sorry, in chemistry, you should think molarity. And if you remember, molarity is mole per liter. So this is a wonderful way for us to actually maybe calculate the amount of reactant I would need or I have, how much product I would need or I would have, and I could calculate in terms of molarity, and then from there I can convert into liters or moles or however I need it. So if I'm actually now provided the KEQ value in my reaction and I have some other concentration values, I can always then calculate the unknown using algebra, and that's what we're going to get into with these last few problems. All right, so if I look at the following reaction, we got a little bit of carbon monoxide reacting with hydrogen gas to produce methane and water. Everything's a gas, so it's homogeneous. It's homogeneous equilibria. And if you notice here, so in the above reaction, the KEQ, now they provided the KEQ for me. And notice that they'll always give you a KEQ at a specific temperature, because we're going to find in the future, you change the temperature, the KEQ value changes. That's the only way it ever changes. So if the chemist reacts a 0.85 molar sample of carbon monoxide with a 1.33 molar sample of hydrogen gas, what will the molarity of methane that should be produced along with? So notice they've given us three. They've given us the water, the hydrogen, and the carbon dioxide. They have not given us the methane. But because they've given us the KEQ, we can go ahead and solve this. So again, anytime I'm given an equilibrium problem, first move, always write the case statement. Just write it down. Get yourself that point. Get your thinking on point, and get going here. So I take both products, because both products are gases, bang, bang, put them in my KEQ statement. I write both reactants, because they too are gases, bang, bang. And so they are in my case statement, and there's my Q. Now, this is where your personal preference comes in. This is where your algebra skills come in. There's some people that love to just plug all the values straight in, plug in this, 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 and your KEQ, and then solve. I'm more of a little bit, I guess, what I would call an old school type person. I like to get my CH4, the thing I'm actually solving for, I like to get that alone first. So what I would do is I would actually reorganize and then plug and chug. So I would try and get rid of the denominator, and so I would multiply by H2 cubed over times CO, and I would put that over H2O, because then I'm going to cancel out all three of these terms from the right side. Whatever you do to the left, you do to the right. So I would multiply all three of these times KEQ. And so I would reorganize this into saying that, okay, the concentration of CH4, which is what you want me to solve for, is the KEQ value times the concentration of CO times the concentration of H2 cubed, and I would put that all over the concentration of H2O. Now from there, I would then simply just plug in my KEQ value. I would plug in my amount of carbon monoxide. I would plug in my amount of hydrogen, and then ultimately, eventually, plug in my amount of water. All right, so I plugged those values in. I plugged in my 3.933, my 0.850, my 1.333, don't forget the cubit. I plugged in my 0.86 molar. When I multiplied out the numerators, I had 3 sig figs as my lowest. So I plugged it all into my calculator and rounded to 3 sig figs. So that's 7.91. Sorry, it's so sloppy. I don't know how to use a calculator, so I did it wrong at first. And then the denominator just stays as it is. I divided the 7.91 by the 0.286, and so I got an answer of 27.7. And they wanted to know the concentration of methane, so that's the amount of molar, 27.7 molar CH4. Now, that number looks a little weird. That number kind of makes me a little bit, like, uneasy. So if I wanted to check myself before I wreck myself, I could plug that value back in with the water, the carbon monoxide, and the hydrogen gas, calculate it out, and I better get 3.933. And if I do, I actually did get that, so I feel very good about this. So again, we're just going to kind of do some algebra here. If you like to reorganize first, if you like to plug and chug first, that does not matter. What does matter is that you show your work and you write this and set this all up all at once. So that's the type of math, and we're going to get much more advanced with it. We're going to get into it deeper in class. But those are the style problems that we'll do. There will be even problems where we ultimately have to solve for a denominator as well. And that's where I really suggest maybe cross multiplication or a reorganize then a plug and chuck. So hope this vodcast helped you understand how to write equilibrium statements and how to do some of the basic math with them. And if not, I apologize, but thanks for watching.